We are at London Book Fair. This is a joyful occasion. It is a book launch. It is a triple book launch by Jane Davis, who is launching Smash All the Windows, and by Dan Holloway, who is launching Hill Land, and by me, I'm launching The Beasts of Electra Drive. So this is LBF 2018, and first of all, chin-chin.
Cheers.
Cheers.
Cheers. And this is the end of a process that's been how long for you to feel that? How long have you been working on it?
I'm not going to comment. I'll say 4 years. That's a good
4 years is good. And you, Jay?
I would say 2 years, although not all of that. Solid writing time, you know,
set aside revisiting. In my case, it was 3 years of solid writing, assisted by development editing by Dan, and now that's been about, that ended, that was from summer 2014 to summer 2017, since which it's been publication stuff, basically.
Yeah.
So yeah, 3 years of actual beavering away, which is a totally different kind of energy from this, you know.
It's, I think it's what would be referred to as slow writing, really.
Yeah.
Perhaps,
yeah.
Not what people think when they think of indie
editors,
many of whom are competing
I can only ever write slowly, and I only ever want to write slowly.
No.
Slow cooking, that's right.
There's nothing wrong with a bit of sushi.
Absolutely. Complicated and slow and demanding, that's what we like. So
I was thinking of the quick and the raw from time to time.
Then preserved and carefully professionally served up. Yeah.
Not the sushi.
Would you like to say anything about essentially what the land focuses upon? What drove it?
It is the premise for it is and the tunnels under Oxford. I was going to pop a QR code.
Please do.
There is
QR code.
Just launched on Kindle. If you go to this QR code, it's 99p. Do download it. And yes, the premise is in the tunnels under Oxford, two women who've never met are about to commit murder together. It's a dark romance stroke literary fiction about outsiders and revenge, whether it's possible to find beauty in a world with no redemption, whether it's possible to create something joyful that has absolutely no possibility of hope.
Francis Bacon used to say, "I'm optimistic about nothing." He has no reason to be optimistic.
This is the artist Francis Bacon,
yes,
not the writer and philosopher Francis Bacon.
Would you echo that, or is it a different sort of tension for you?
I find optimism in the fact that there is no optimism. I find hope utterly dispiriting. Because hope is always disappointed and frustrated.
Right.
Whereas if we accept.
Because if you're pessimistic, then you're constantly delighted by things, whereas if you're optimistic,
you're constantly disappointed. Yeah. Where do you put yourself on that scale? Do you have a pessimism and optimism, essentially? Within you, do you think? Okay. I have a kind of upkicker in terms of mood and spirit that is not really originating in my mind. My mind is darker, so I'm not going to complain about the upkicker.
Your mind is dark, Rohan. Your mind is.
It feels fairly dark. It feels dark and bright.
Your mind is. Well, you know what I think of you. I think of you and your work as the Dick Van Dyke of the literary world.
Yeah, thank you. Thank
the
you.
Most delicious way.
Thank you.
Unique, utterly unique.
He means Dick Van Dyke in Mary Poppins in particular.
Just in case there was another one.
Well, no, as opposed to Dick Van Dyke in Diagnosis Murder.
Sorry. Yeah.
I'm specifically thinking of the Cockney accent, which is. There is a dissonance in your thought.
Yeah.
That at first is very, very disquieting, but then actually, once you leave it, it's both joyful and dark at the same time.
And it happens both live and on the page in the same way, does it?
It does, yes. And I wonder sometimes, reading your book, not knowing you, would be a very different experience from reading your book knowing you. Because there are times, like, with Jaymi's voice, I can hear the Rohan, the twinkle. There's a delicious twinkle to the narrator.
That's the Cockney cheeky champion.
It is interesting to say that, because I had only just met you when I read the novella, so I've sort of got to know you through your connection to
having got to know me, how did that reconfigure the initial impression you got from the books? Having first read me, then got to know me.
Well, I thought it's interesting.
What did that change?
Interesting in that you used grand face on one of yours, so I've never thought it was intended to be quite 100% fiction, because I don't think many would choose to put their own face on one of their book covers. Usually a discreet little author shot at the back. But we were speaking last week about, you know, how much of your DNA is a book.
Very true. I should just note that in this case I have a slightly greater excuse than just egotism for putting this on the front. It is that I was visually established, as they say in the film land, established as the performer of my narrator on screen, because there's a bunch of film material that was embedded in the ebook format. Not the paperback, but in the ebook format we embedded film, audio and photographic material of The Imagination Thief, and in those films, which add up to about an hour of original film, I am established as the narrator, so I've got half an excuse. I admit it's only half. There was a previous version or title of this, or is that something you're not any longer thinking about?
Of my book?
Yes, yes.
Yes, that was why I was hesitant to say how long I've been working on it.
Sure. Doesn't matter. Yeah.
It came out in ebook format 4 years ago.
Yes.
And it's only now available in paperback. But I've coupled it with a second story also set in Oxford.
Stitch.
It's called Stitch, which is... It was commissioned by Oxford Playhouse for a series called Dark Fairy Tales. And it was running during Easter when they had a load of children's fairy tales on during the day, and then they wanted some adult fairy tales on night. So after the UI performed it, it's a 45-minute performance piece. So I performed it at Burton Taylor Theatre in Oxford, which was absolutely wonderful. And it's a retelling of The Monkey's Paw,
right,
also set in the subterranean Oxford. It's a teenage retelling of The Monkey's Paw with gender-fluid vampires and high-tech. High-tech vampirism. I have added that to crew to with this subterranean Oxford world.
And how did this differ from your previous titles, Jane? Because I know you've written 8 at this point, which is certainly more than I've read you in a bit. 8 novels. See you later. And this was the most what, or the least what, out of all of those?
This is the only, or the first book that I've collaborated with Dan on.
Yeah.
Yes.
And Dan is the thread that links all of our 3 books, if you like.
Yes, I'm certainly thread there, yes.
Special editor as well. It is probably my most contemporary novel to date, so I think that's where it where it differs, and it's probably a bit angrier than previous novels.
Because it was inspired by the Hillsborough disaster and the full sense of closure that was attributed to the victims of that.
Well, the idea that after 27 years of trying to overturn a miscarriage of justice, to clear the names of your loved ones, that when that actually happened, that you would just be able to return to your life as was, and of course your life can never be, that life isn't there to return to, and even if it were, you would be a very different person, so you would not be able to return to.
And you made a rich, detailed, fictional disaster of a comparable kind, didn't you?
I did, based on a personal experience I had, which was actually on the way to a book reading with a suitcase full of books. They're actually very heavy, and I don't recommend taking them down escalators.
But
I had someone. Yes, I had someone brush past me. Look, there's a pigeon again. I had someone brush past me and knocked my suitcase. And my suitcase walked me forward down the escalators. I had fallen on the escalators. So it is. Fortunately, there was no one directly in front of me, so things didn't go too badly wrong. But actually, since I put this book out there to with advanced readers, there's a large number of people who've had problems on escalators and tube stations. It obviously happens quite often, and to be honest, it does amaze me that it doesn't end up with serious
And that was the device through which we then explored the emotions and the motivations and the conflicts, etc.
It's very much about the emotional fallout of the incident rather than the incident itself. And it's about, you know, in the period afterwards where people are trying to return to whatever degree of normality they can achieve. And actually it was Dan who described two of my characters as guides in the book. So I have a character called Eric, and the one who becomes his wife, Sorrel, who are actually mapping together this sequence of hundreds of tiny little elements that gave rise to the event, to show that the incident was almost done. And that it was foreseeable. So we have him sort of as a guide through the novel. And then we also have a character called Charles Roche, who is French. And he creates art from his grief. So he channels all that negative energy, if you like, into something positive. And following the announcement of the verdict, Tate Modern offer him an exhibition of his work. He's been a minor celeb before that. He became the unwitting face of the disaster, as it were.
Right.
And so he's quite reluctant about fame. It wasn't something that he ever wanted to happen. But he's the kind of person who will say yes, but will say yes on his terms. So his terms are that it becomes a collaboration with the other families of the victims, and that he uses all of their mementos to create this exhibition. So we know we're moving towards the disaster through all the eyes of the different people involved.
Yeah.
We're moving towards what we know will be an exhibition, and we know it won't be closure, but we know that it will be, perhaps the beginnings of healing.
Lots to juggle, so many elements to juggle.
Yeah, this is why I needed Dan's help. So he said, take the chapters and shuffle them.
Okay.
That's the advice you get if you work with an editor, just take the chapters and shuffle them. That's actually been the theme of this book fair, because on the blockchain panel we were talking about B.S. Johnson's The Unfortunate, which is the book that was written with each page as a chapter unbound.
Yes.
So you literally shuffle them and read the book in whatever order you want to read it.
But the work that you take to get you to the stage where you can actually do that, because each page has to be capable of being read.
Yes.
Like that.
It's extraordinary.
Enormous. Yeah. I don't think I could possibly work in that way.
I suppose my equivalent of that sort of essential insight through the editorial process was probably that through these beasts, which are human-appearing characters in games that are designed by my protagonist, who's a games designer, through those beasts which run around and wreak havoc and love in Los Angeles, LA is on the cover, that's the skyline of LA, through these beasts I am reflecting the complexity of the world as complexly and accurately as I can, which also is a big juggling act. And one of the unifying things that we came up with was to take those disparate dozens of reflections and unify them through a kind of his own internal emotional journey to bring that out. Or perhaps it would have been brought out to give him a single journey within himself, an emotional journey of reintegration of some sort, essentially.
You're making me sound like a Jung here.
I am, exactly.
So I'm absolutely not a Jung.
No, but you did mention Jung as
I did mention Jung as
a comparison to this sort of thing.
It is that sort of idea of it. Yes, you reintegrate, and you reintegrate quite unpleasant. The result of the reintegration isn't necessarily a fully healed.
That's right. I will say that my protagonist is no saint. Two people end up dead at his hands via his beasts. His characters, his beasts, commit those murders. So he is no saint, that's true. But you know what? What I think we should do is stop jabbing for a moment, refill things. We've got a little bit of drink here, not a huge amount. I should just say, before anybody doubts that there'll be more drink, that from 4 p.m. across the street, Hand of Flower, very, very generously sponsored by KDP, there is free drink, and I have Orna's permission to mention that you are welcome to come across the street, because you've been here, you are welcome to the allowed to be the book author's party that's occurring in the Hand and Flower directly across the street by the train tracks. Ask somebody if you don't know. It's the Hand and Flower till 7. Open bar. What's not to like? So come and join us for that if you like. But right for now, I do believe Jane has got some booze. Dan's going to give out some QR codes.
I'm going to be boring. Do take QR codes. Anyone who works for them, just a link.
Also, while he's giving those out, these are for sale. These are enormously fun and lovely. Mine are £10. Jane are a very similar price. She'll tell you what they are. I don't know. But mine are £10. Dan's are, he'll tell you what his is.
Mine are £5.99.
So, 5, 10, we've got some change, feel free. There they are. And that's
an e-book person.
The very best.
You do?
The very best. And you've got to grab them quickly because it's a very unstained glass.
I've got to.
Because it's easier to read the thing.
Let's fix my glass back to the.
You wouldn't read off screen.
I read off screen.
On the Kindle screen rather than the computer screen.
Yeah.
Because it's glaring.
Professional.
Which means it's attached.
Hello.
Hello.
Cheers.
How are you doing?
We're fine, thank you.
Good.
And this has been a prequel. This novel is a prequel to the 5 other titles of mine that you see. We're going to go through each of our books now. Mine, Dan's, and Jane's.
Okay.
Mine are there on the left behind Jane.
Yep.
So if we slide over. The current title is a prequel, which is... Beasts of Electra Drive here.
Yep.
And the 4 titles to which it is a prequel are these up here. You will observe a similarity between this gorgeous platinum blonde here and this gorgeous platinum blonde here. I don't know who she is, she's a print model somewhere.
And is it the same character?
Yes, it's a character called the Platinum Raven. She is one of the half dozen beasts which are human appearing games characters that my protagonist unleashes. First of all, designs in great detail through creation cycles in his laptop, and then incarnates. They slither out like Sadako in the Ring horror movie. They slither out through his monitor into meat space and run around and wreak love and havoc in Los Angeles. So she is one of those. In particular, she embodies transcendence. All that needs transcending and how to transcend that, how to float in dignity and majesty. Yes, the beasts do different things, not in simplistic ways, but you can say certain basic things about each of them, and in her case it is transcendence, is the simplest way of putting it. She's also an embodiment of myself as a creator of the whole thing and of all the rest, which is why she's on the cover, because I've created the books and there she is kind of embodying me, so hence she's on the cover. But that's what she is anyway.
So there's elements of you in her?
And in all the characters, all the main beasts, yes.
Do you want to tell us what those elements are? Or?
Yes, there's the 6 beasts, the half dozen beasts, are Amber, who's a kind of embodiment of vengeance and darkness, which we all have somewhere in us.
Oh, yeah.
There is a character called Evelyn, who's very sunny and very centred and very cool and sassy and a bit streetwise, and she's lovely. There is Shigem, who is very flamboyant and androgynous and cool and kind of charismatic in a nightclubby way. There's a very thoughtful beast called Kim, who is Shigem's boyfriend, who is designed by Jaymi, my protagonist, to be Shigem's boyfriend. He's much more thoughtful, much more minor key in his personality. And there is her, penultimately, who I've just described. And finally there is Scorpio, who's a ferociously dark and sensual creature who kind of gives gives the lie to the idea that somebody should be either cleanly male or cleanly female. And he's, as I say, extremely dark, sensual, and he's clearly another side of one as well. So those are the beasts.
Why did you choose LA?
Because I'd lived there for 2 periods of 1 year each, either side of my decade in New York, and I didn't particularly like LA, but you don't have to like something in order to be interested in it. I was fascinated by it, not least by the utterly dysfunctional and I have some affection for it, the sheer unwieldiness of how it's laid out. It's infamously unwieldy geographically, and you've got these fabulous, luxurious mansions up on the Hollywood hills that we've seen in Mulholland Drive by David Lynch and Lost Highway by David Lynch, etc. And you've got very different areas. Skid Row is the biggest homeless population in America. That's on the fringes of downtown, next to quite a lot of money, banks and so forth. You've got awful contrast with Skid Row, which is right there on the east, northeast fringe of downtown. That's another big setting in the book. There's a gigantic refinery by the ocean next to a shrieking airport beside a huge power station. I love that minerality, that marginality of environment. So there was a lot to use, there was a lot to make use of in my memory. It was a number of years ago that I was there, but I finally have made use of it in this book. For the first time properly. It popped up briefly in the other books, but this is the first time I've used it properly. So, yeah, there's an overview.
Thank you for that. And happy endings? Would you say life has a happy ending, or your book have a happy ending?
It's not a miserable ending. It is a somewhat dark ending, but it's not a sad or miserable one. No, it's an ambiguous. Morally, it's an ambiguous one. In that, my protagonist, as I mentioned, is responsible for the deaths of two individuals. He thinks they deserve it. In some ways, they do, but in another sense, nobody deserves to be killed. So, not that it's a murder mystery, but that's one tiny element of, you know, what's happening in it. So it's very dark and explosive and strange and peculiar. It is literary fiction with a touch of magical realism and a dusting of horror. That's the general picture. It's also been seen as sci-fi, which is cool. I like that. That's fine as well. But its main listings are literary fiction, magical realism and horror.
And who would be the director of your film?
Either Guillermo del Toro, in my dreams, David Lynch, those are the two names that spring to mind. There's a magical realist intensity to Guillermo del Toro. I will, in due course, investigate the possibilities of licensing film rights, absolutely. I'm aware that that is easier said than done. However, I will absolutely investigate it. I know, you know, certain things about LA and certain things about the film biz, although not from a very empowered position. But that can change. I can help to cause that to change. Hopefully, we'll see.
And moving forward, where do you go from here? Obviously, you're just.
I'm not going to write anything more for a year or two because there's a lot else I need to catch up with, which I should have done years ago, of a more businessy kind. Well, I should have done 2 years ago, of a more businessy kind. To do with getting stuff out there and, you know, mechanical stuff behind the scenes, etc. I should have done that. So I need to catch up with all that. I'm deliberately not thinking about what I may write next in 2 years' time. Not yet.
Wait and see.
Yes.
Well, wait and see, Rohan.
Yes. That's probably enough right for now. Unless we want to have another word on camera, one-to-one. Sarah is kindly catching one-to-one
sound bites. You know, talking about the characters, yes. Going into a bit more detail. What made you decide to write this book? What was your...
Well, it was watching the announcement. It was watching the family members come out from the courtroom of the second inquest for the Hillsborough disaster and having cameras thrust in their faces yet again and being asked, of course, after 27 years, you know, now you can get on with your lives. And that seemed just extraordinary to me. And bearing in mind that they'd already been very, very hard done by at the hands of the press, the victims had been turned into villains in the piece.
Absolutely.
And so I deconstructed the Hillsborough disaster we like and took all of the elements that I could find from that. So someone being new to a job, you know, the press element. I basically deconstructed and made a sequence of the events that we knew about in the aftermath of the accident we didn't know at the time, and the new evidence that came forward in the second inquest. And then when I created a fictional incident, I made sure that those elements were involved, you know, were included in the fictional incident. But
yes.
Then I had to go and do the research for the basis of my fiction incident,
yes.
As well. So
can I ask you where it's set? Where is your story set?
It's set within the city of London.
It is London.
And it's an invented tube station. But if you can imagine the underground tunnels between Bank and Monument and how those two tube stations are linked together, because what happened to me the day I had my accident was the escalators that I normally use were closed off. They were out of service, and I was diverted through tunnels to that I was unfamiliar with, and down what is one of the steepest escalators in the underground system, and you literally stand at the top, and I suffer from vertigo anyway, so even before I so fairly hideous for me to get into on these anyway, and then it was a really, really steep drop. Drop down. So, but I changed the names of the. So I've invented. I've had several people contact me already and say, we've looked these stations up on the tube map. It's St. Boltorf and Old Billingsgate, which is an area that I know quite well from working in the City of London. And there's things like Riverside, a Riverside walk included in the book, and it's the route that I take through the city to the offices I go to in the city. So it's all areas that I know quite well and a journey that I have to do often as well.
But, absolutely. It's a bit of a rat race, isn't it?
Thankfully, I don't have to do it anything like every day. It's only an occasional thing for me, but I couldn't do it every day.
No. And how have you found the London Book Fair? Have you enjoyed it?
Yes, it's the fourth year I've come.
Yep.
Every year I come, there's more authors attending. This is the first year that Ally has had its own stand as well. So
good.
That's amazing.
That is good.
It feels like that we have a home here, and more of a voice here. And there's so many talks now that are aimed at authors. For me, at my stage in my journey, I'm 8 novels in. I've been traditionally published and self-published since 2012. I feel that quite a lot of it is aimed at first-time self-publishers and people who are looking for services and things like that. I'd like to see a little bit more for the more experienced self-publisher from a personal point of view. But I'm here more for the book launch, but also the networking, because that's fabulous. I mean, we don't get many times that we can, you know, all meet up together.
It's been fun. This is
kind of,
I've been going to London Book Fair since about 2012.
So you earlier than me.
And they've each had a different flavour. The first time I had kind of a co-publisher, the Thirsty Group, who were co-publishing my e-book edition of The Imagination Thief, the one that includes all that video and audio and photographic material I was talking about, so it was a little bit more techy, so that's why I had them on board as a co-publisher. And I came in 2012 solely with one meeting in mind, which was with them. The following year, it began to sort of blossom outwards, and I knew a lot of people. And yesterday I was lying on Donald Trump's desk, which is a setup of. Well, so were you actually, yes.
It would be rude not to.
It would be, yes.
While he wasn't looking.
That's right. There is a mock up of the Oval Office over there, a gimmick to sell a book by two enormously famous people called James Patterson and Bill Clinton. So we were. I'm looking at Sarah now because she was also actually in the Oval Office at the same time, weren't you?
We were. It was good. It's just a shame Bill Clinton didn't turn up and a stooge of a Donald Trump did, unfortunately. And I was really hoping that the president was missing, but sadly he was found.
Sadly. Bill was a good time guy, wasn't he? Bill was a good time president.
Bit better.
Yeah.
He plays the saxophone as well, doesn't he?
He got stoned.
I went to Prague and there was a jazz club. And apparently he used to just turn up on a regular basis with his sax and play in this jazz
there
club.
There it is.
And they had pictures of him all over the wall.
That's amazing.
And all of the staff knew him. Apparently he was one of these people who recognised people's faces and remembered their names, neither of which I'm any good at. But he would know everybody by name. You know, the person who served him coffee, the person who, you know, bought him beer, whatever. He just remembered. He was absolutely amazing with people. And he was incredibly popular over there. And he would just rock up with his
sax. Awesome. Makes him a human being.
You didn't want to get into
that's the
heavy
thing.
I've heard it said that when he comes up to you, you get what's called the full bill. This has been written about. It means the hand around the shoulder, it means the gaze straight into the eyes, it means the caring, asking about you immediately, enveloping you.
Oh, I love that. I must try it myself.
The full Sarah.
Very contemporary, very accessible to people who are not interested.
Oh, it's been really cool. It's been a great week.
Thank you very much. We'll wrap up now.
My pleasure.
It's a book launch, in case you've tuned in late. This has been a book launch for three titles. It's been a book launch for Smash All the Windows by Jane Davis.
The Beasts of Electra Drive by Rohan Quine.
And Kill Land by Dan Holloway. So three titles, somewhere over there. Three titles, and this has been the London Book Fair. In fact, come join us. I thought he'd gone, but now we get.
No, I'm just here.
We get this.
So, wonderful. We wish you all the success.
Thank you.
Thank you.
And all that, yeah. Bring it on.
Cheers.
Yay.
Bye.